This is the way now. I'm traveling from Pakistan to Afghanistan, but I cannot speak loudly because the driver will be suspicious while I'm taking the movie.
On May 26, 2004, I left the United States and flew to Quetta, Pakistan. From Quetta, we drove to Kabul on the Chaman Highway, passing through the city of Kandahar, the spiritual home of Taliban. I'm excited to enter my home country after 2 decades of absence. My aim is to go to Kabul, Bamiyan, and Mazar Sharif, the 3 places where Hazara were being massacred. I want to see the mass grave sites, see the victim families, the survivor of Taliban massacres and prisoner, and record their life stories. Massacres took place in Bamiyan in 1998. Once the Taliban war in Bamiyan, many males over the age of 13 were arrested and killed. The Taliban retook Bamiyan in 1999. Their hatred of Hazara was so strong that they killed everyone they saw. This is the burial site of a family who lost 27 members during the Taliban. When I saw the family, I started crying for their loss and seeing their misery. The story of them reminded me of the story of my own family. We lost 26 members in the war. As a child, I always saw my aunts, my mother, when they were getting together and crying for their loss.
Most of the massacre happening here, especially those people, they were killed in the cities and bazaar and most of the community. And the Taliban brought them by cars and here and also bear and just dropped them there in this big hole.
I talked with many eyewitnesses about the massacre they saw. Human Rights Watch estimated that up to 2,000 people were killed and most likely more in Mazar-e-Sharif.
Still, we can find the wounds of all those dead bodies and their clothes. And also they can find some other things which showing at least a number of people, more than 600 people were killed here. So now we are going to search to find, maybe we can find by ourselves also some part of their body or some, especially clothing is obvious. You can see the one is the black clothes here, the piece of black. One of the eyewitnesses said that they came and put some of the rocks, some of the rocks or dust to prevent from the bad smelling to spread in this town.
There were massacres in Afshar Courtesy section of Kabul in February 1993. The residents were attacked while they were asleep in their beds. By the time it was over, more than 700 people were estimated to have disappeared or being killed. Mass graves were discovered a year later. Human Rights Watch reported that civilians had their throats slit and legs or arms cut off. More than 1,000 were killed and disappeared. After 2001, the Taliban could not move easily in Afghanistan to harm Hazara. They started harming Hazara in Quetta, Pakistan. There were 5 terrorist attacks on Hazara population in Quetta, Pakistan. The 3 of them were major ones. On July 4, 2003, the attack was on Hazara Mosque in Quetta, Pakistan, killing 53 people and injuring 65. On March 2, 2004, there were another terrorist attack on persecution of Hazara citizens in Quetta during Muharram, the holy month of Shia Islam. 53 Hazara people were killed, over 150 injured. I met this woman in hospital Yakaulang, Bamiyan. Her story reflects the story of many women I met. She was a widow woman, and the daily pressure, pain, memories, and torment that filled her mind at home and caused her to scream continuously and pass out. Her mind was not in the room with me. She was quiet and focused her gaze on one spot of hospital room wall. She was mostly unresponsive to my questions or those around her. Each of these women had a story of misery to tell me. All of them were widows and young orphan girls who lost their male family member during the Taliban era because they were Hazara. Their story shocked me. I was screaming and crying so badly that I had only tears to share with them. I could not believe what I was hearing from them. Each of their words were about loss, loss, loss. Each of their stories were screaming oppression and cruelty of Taliban against Hazara ethnic. The massacre of Hazara reached the level of genocide. The testimony of all eyewitnesses of the massacre proved the fact that targeting Hazara people were genocidal in a form of ethnic cleansing. They even killed Hazara baby because they represented future Hazara. Hazara men were killed in front of their families and children to traumatize them. The elder men were allowed to leave to witness the massacres. While massacring Hazara, they target the faces and heads of Hazara men to send a message to Hazara community. They wanted to obliterate the faces of Hazara just like they wanted to obliterate the Hazara population. I also found the destruction of Buddha was another example of hatred of Hazara face, because the Buddha had a Mongolian face. The Taliban did not want that face to remain as a historical symbol for Hazara people. They burned all the bazaar in Bamiyan, Yakaulang, and Siakhak because those bazaar were a source of income for Hazaras. They knew that by destroying income sources, the Hazara would suffer serious consequences, so they used the Taliban used the dehumanization tool of oppression as a way of fighting Hazara. When I was about to leave Kota for Afghanistan, my cousin asked me if I had chaudhary. I said no. He said your Hazaragi face will put you in terrible danger, particularly in Kandahar where the biggest concentration of Taliban is. I decided to not wear the chaudhary but wear the big veil to cover my face on the way. When I came back from Afghanistan, I was more aware of trouble and danger my face could cause me, so I gave up my stubbornness to not wear it. When I went to Afghanistan, I was more aware and concerned because of being woman, but in return, I was more concerned and aware of danger of being Hazara. My fear was not being a woman, my fear was being a Hazara woman. I was aware of my dual identity.
Oh my goodness, I cannot see. So, it looks beautiful because it's white, but it's not a good one for me. Probably.
Children in Afghanistan has no childhood. The harshness of life does not give them a chance for childhood. They are suffering and struggling with their family for survival. In Bamiyan, I saw children in a cave barely living and just asking for money to buy something to eat and to buy cream to use on their wrinkled faces. I asked most of them what are their dreams. They said their dreams were to have a house, not to live in a cave because they feel cold.
Now we are in school of Shuhada in Yakaulang. So when I see the children in school, class 1 or class 4, I exactly remember my time when I was in a camp, refugee camp, and under the tent. Even they are better than me because they have a chalk, they have blackboard, and they have also teachers here. So we were in the time when I was in class 1 like them, I had exactly the same situation in refugee camp. So now I don't want to even leave the tent because I remember it's completely my childhood from the time which I have started. And I had no future and I had no dream and I was just thinking, just I can't read and write. When I see now them, I can see a bright future for them.
The brighter future of children is coming from the hard work that has done by women like Dr. Seema Summer, who is building schools for children. Her strong character and determination are the backbone of resilience and agency.
And when I see, I mean, it's very simple. We just had 300 students from one district mm-hmm. coming to university. That was a result of course, long, mm-hmm. long tiring work, but it is a result. is it a positive? It's a positive reason.
That gives you energy.
Yeah, which gave me hope and energy. Mm-hmm. And I don't think we can achieve anything with gun anymore in this country.
As I reflect back upon my trip in 2004, I am still overwhelmed by intensity of pain, suffering and tragedy that I saw and felt among many Hazara, particularly among Hazara women. The shared history gave us all comfort and made us feel close to each other. I was deeply touched by their difficulties and understood their situation. Through my research, I have learned to uncover the face of oppression from my country. The trip was a discovery process for me to understand who I am, how my identity was formed. Their identity constructed my identity. Their stories empowered me to understand what does it mean to be a woman in Hazara in Afghanistan. There were many voices that called to me to listen to their words of sadness, helplessness, and hopelessness. I listened to them all and realized what tremendous importance the ethnicity has played in the life of Hazara. What I saw, what I heard has changed my life forever. I will never be the same again. Yet out of this horrendous history of persecution, oppression, hatred, and genocide, I have seen sign of hope, strength, determination, and pride of Hazara people as they continue to struggle for equal access to opportunity, justice, and development funds for all their communities. The strength and hope of Hazara people can be sustained with the help of the international community. Support must reach them. Otherwise, their voices will remain unheard and they will be left to struggle on their own without any support or aid.